Good day and welcome back. We'll talk about quantum physics. This video will include the photon and the wave particle duality. Basically, photoelectric effect is one of the most important studies in quantum physics. It is the emission of photoelectrons from a metal surface when illuminated with electromagnetic radiation in simple light. It is explained by Albert Einstein, which introduced the photon, where the photon is a discrete package of light energy. The energy of photon is given as E equal to hf or hc over lambda, where h is the Planck constant. Let's discuss a few things about the photoelectric effect. So this is the experiment that can show the photoelectric effect when we shine the light on the light-sensitive metal. Well, the electron is binded on the metal. There is minimum energy required to release the electron, which is known as work function. The term of minimum energy is applied on the electron on the metal surface. For electron inside the metal, they receive lesser light, which require higher intensity, which will be mentioned again later on. So the work function here determines the frequency of light required, and it has different value based on type of metal used in the experiment. Therefore, there is threshold frequency for the photoelectric effect to occur, which is proposed in the quantum theory. After the photoelectron is released, they will be attracted to the positively charged anode, and then we can observe the current flow in a complete circuit. So until now, we haven't really discussed what is quantum theory about. It is a theory used to explain something that cannot be explained by the classical theory, such as the photoelectric effect. If we refer to classical theory, which mentioned the light wave is a spectrum with continuous energy, and that's what we have learned about so far. Think of something like we dry our clothes under the sun or other light sources. The light which also carry heat energy able to dry our clothes, which is at any frequency, and it just took some time for the clothes to dry. However, in the photoelectric effect experiment, it is found that only light with certain frequency able to trigger the phenomenon, and the process is instantaneous. This is not according to the classical theory, and this is why we have quantum physics today. Another thing to mention is the intensity of light. Classical theory says that the light intensity will affect the speed of emission. Brighter light has higher energy, which allows the electron to escape in a shorter period of time with higher kinetic energy. However, the reality is that the intensity of light only affects the rate of electron release. It allows more electrons to escape, which gives higher value of current, since current is the rate of flow of charge. About the kinetic energy, we'll look at the formula later, which shows it depends on the light frequency. So now we know that the light supply energy to the electron in metal in the form of discrete energy package, or also known as photons. The photon energy supply we use to overcome the work function, then become the kinetic energy of the photoelectron. Hence, we have the equation of the photon energy equal to the work function plus kinetic energy. For the minimal work function, it is when the electron receives energy that is just enough for them to escape, but with zero kinetic energy. So from here, we can obtain that W is equal to hf naught, where f naught is the threshold frequency. Overall, we can express the kinetic energy is hf minus w, or h multiplied the difference between the frequency and the threshold frequency. Before we discuss further, we shall talk also the stopping potential. If you recall about the cathode ray production in semester 2, then we apply potential difference to accelerate the electron. The stopping potential is the other way around, that we apply reverse potential to stop the emission of photoelectrons. Both concepts are different, but the formula are actually quite similar, that we have the electric potential energy is equal to the kinetic energy of the electron. The difference here is that we use reverse potential to counter the kinetic energy, so this stopping potential is not about the energy conversion. So let's discuss a few questions. First is from SMK YU HUA in 2021. So this is one of the graphs which shows the variation of photocurrent and potential difference applied. Two things you can analyze. First is on the negative x-axis, which is when the reverse potential is applied to reduce the kinetic energy of electron. When the current is zero, the reverse potential is the stopping potential that is required to completely stop the emission of photoelectron. Second thing is about the saturation current, is when the current doesn't increase further when we increase the voltage. This is because we have all the photoelectron release are bring to the positive terminal. To increase the saturation current, we can increase the light intensity, which can release more electron from the metal, as I mentioned just now. We move on to a question from KOLEJ TINGKATAN ENAM PETALING JAYA in 2021. So this is just a brief about the formula we have learned today. We are given with the work function of the metal and the wavelength. One thing special in this chapter is to learn about the unit conversion between the electron volt EV to joule. This is simply just multiplied or divided by the electron charge. We shall go through the question. This question is about the threshold frequency, that W is hf naught. So we can get the threshold frequency easily when we have the work function. Next is to obtain the maximum velocity. There's a different way that you can also use the equation of E equal to W plus K. You can try to do it on your own. Last is the stopping potential. We have the electric potential energy to counter the kinetic energy. So we have EV is equal to the kinetic energy. So I guess this will be not a big problem for you. Just take some time to do it on your own, and I have provided the solution here for you. We move on to the last question, which is also from SMK YU HUA. This question is quite interesting, that it is a graph of kinetic energy against the frequency, which is a common graph we use in photoelectric experiment. Here you could see different matter react differently to different frequency of light. But there's one thing is common between them, and that is the gradient of the graph. Let's discuss about the graph equation. We learned the equation of K is equal to HF minus W, or K equal to HF minus HF naught. Work function is a constant value for each metal. Compared to Y equal to MX plus C, the gradient of the graph is the Planck constant, which is why all the metals are showing the same gradient, since the Planck constant is a constant value. For the Y-intercept, which is not shown in the graph, it is a negative value, which is the work function. When the kinetic energy is zero, the X-intercept shown in the graph is the threshold frequency. So after you understand those few things about the graph, let's quickly go through the question. First is the value of Planck constant, which is the gradient of the graph. One reminder here is about the unit conversion. You can try to do it on your own. Next is the work function of aluminium. Let's read the x-intercept for the aluminium, which is the threshold frequency, and you can apply the formula of W equal to HF naught. Last is the threshold wavelength of beryllium. Remember the formula of V equal to F lambda, where the velocity of light is 3 times 10 to the power F meter per second. So before we end, we shall discuss also the wave particle duality. From the photoelectric experiment, we have seen that light, which is wave, exhibit particle properties. According to D. Broglie, he stated the hypothesis that matter should have also wave-like properties, which is the other way around. So we have learned about the particle which has mass, momentum, etc., while the phenomena of light, which include reflection, refraction, and diffraction. D. Broglie introduced the wave particle duality, which states that both objects possess both particle and wave-like properties under some condition. You can quickly obtain the formula of D. Broglie wavelength is H over MC, where MC is also the momentum. So this is the hypothesis proposed by the D. Broglie. In the year of 1927, the wave particle duality hypothesis is proven with the diffraction pattern exhibited by the electron, which is clearly a subatomic particle. So now, there's a question that why we don't see the wave particle duality in our surrounding. Well, diffraction phenomena is obvious when the wavelength is longer and the size of aperture is smaller. Based on the D. Broglie wavelength, that we can see the Planck constant has a very, very small value. The wavelength is shorter when the mass of particle is larger. So this is why we cannot observe the wave particle duality of the normal object, because the D. Broglie wavelength proposed is too short to demonstrate the wave properties. In conclusion, light and the subatomic particles such as the electron, proton, and neutron, which has very low mass, able to demonstrate the wave particle duality. So lastly, we shall talk about the electron microscope, which is invented after the wave particle duality is proven. It has better performance than the usual optical microscope because that electron has shorter wavelength than the visible light. According to the resolving power we learned in topic 23.5, the shorter the wavelength, the smaller the angle required to resolve images, and this gives us higher resolving power. So here you can see the electron microscope able to give a sharper image on the red blood cell compared to the normal optical microscope. So that's all for my discussion today. If you still have any questions, leave in the comment section below. Thank you.